chapter 22, page 214. 22. Now the landscape was changing. It was a subtle change, hard to identify at first. The road was narrower and bumpy, apparently no longer tended by road crews. It was harder suddenly to balance on the bike, as the front wheel wobbled over stones and ruts. One night, Jonas fell, when the bike jolted to a sudden stop against a rock. He grabbed instinctively for Gabriel, and the new child, strapped tightly in his seat, was uninjured, only frightened when the bike fell to its side. But Jonas's ankle was twisted, and his knees were scraped and raw, blood seeping through his torn trousers. Painfully, he righted himself and the bike, and reassured Gabe. Tentatively, he began to ride in daylight. He had forgotten the fear of the searchers, who seemed to have diminished into the past, but now there were new fears. The unfamiliar landscape held hidden, unknown perils. Trees became more numerous, and the forests beside the road were dark and thick with mystery. They saw streams more frequently now and stopped often to drink. Jonas carefully washed his injured knees, wincing as he rubbed at the raw flesh. The constant ache of his swollen ankle was eased when he soaked it occasionally in the cold water that rushed through roadside gullies. He was newly aware that Gabriel's safety depended entirely upon his own continued strength. They saw their first waterfall, and for the first time, wildlife. "Plane, plane!" Gabriel called, and Jonas turned swiftly into the trees, though he had not seen a plane in days and he did not hear an aircraft engine now. When he stopped the bicycle in the shrubbery and turned to grab Gabe, he saw the small, chubby arm pointing toward the sky. Terrified, he looked up, but it was not a plane at all, though he had never seen one before. He identified it from his fading memories, for the giver had given them to him often. It was a bird. Soon there were many birds along the way, soaring overhead, calling. They saw deer, and once, beside the road, looking at them curious and unafraid, a small, reddish-brown creature with a thick tail, whose name Jonas did not know. He slowed the bike, and they stared at one another until the creature turned away and disappeared into the woods. All of it was new to him. After a life of sameness and predictability, he was awed by the surprises that lay beyond each curve of the road. He slowed the bike again and again to look at with wonder at wildflowers, to enjoy the throaty warble of a new bird nearby, or merely to watch the way wind shifted the leaves in the trees. During his 12 years in the community, he had never felt such simple moments of exquisite happiness. But there were desperate fears building in him now as well. The most relentless of his new fears was that they would starve. Now that they had left the cultivated fields behind them, it was almost impossible to find food. They finished the meager store of potatoes and carrots they had saved from the last agricultural area, and now they were always hungry. Jonas knelt by a stream and tried without success to catch a fish with his hands. Frustrated, he threw rocks into the water, knowing even as he did that it was useless. Finally, in desperation, he fashioned a makeshift net, looping the strands of Gabriel's blanket around a curved stick. After countless tries, the net yielded two flopping silvery fish. Methodically, Jonas hacked them to pieces with a sharp rock and fed the raw shreds to himself and to Gabriel. They ate some berries and tried without success to catch a bird. At night, while Gabriel slept beside him, Jonas lay awake, tortured by hunger, and remembered his life in the community where meals were delivered to each dwelling every day. He tried to use the flagging power of his memory to recreate meals, and managed brief, tantalizing fragments, banquets with huge roasted meats, birthday parties with thick, frosted cakes, and lush fruits picked and eaten, sun-warmed and dripping from trees. When the memory glimpses subsided, he was left with the gnawing, painful emptiness. Jonas remembered suddenly and grimly the time in his childhood when he had been chastised for misusing a word. The word had been starving. "You have never been starving," he had been told. "You will never be starving." Now he was. If he had stayed in the community, he would not be. It was as simple as that. Once he had yearned for choice. Then, when he had had a choice, he had made the wrong one, the choice to leave, and now he was starving. But if he stayed, his thoughts continued, if he had stayed, he would have starved in other ways. He would have lived a life hungry for feelings, for color, for love. And Gabriel? For Gabriel, there would have been no life at all. So there had not really been a choice. It became a struggle to ride the bicycle as Jonas weakened from lack of food and realized at the same time that he was encountering something he had for a long time yearned to see. Hills. His sprained ankle throbbed as he forced the pedal downward in an effort that was almost beyond him. And the weather was changing. It rained for 2 days. Jonas had never seen rain, though he had experienced it often in the memories. He had liked those rains, enjoyed the new feeling of it, but this was different. He and Gabriel became cold and wet, and it was hard to get dry even when sunshine occasionally followed. Gabriel had not cried during the long, frightening journey. Now he did. He cried because he was hungry and cold and terribly weak. Jonas cried too for the same reasons, and another reason as well. He wept because he was afraid now that he could not save Gabriel. He no longer cared about himself.